About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your house, whoops!
I'm sorry.
Is that your phone?
Yeah, it's actually in my coat.
Do you want to get his coat? Did somebody get his coat so that we can stop the noise from his cell phone?
Just let it go.
Okay, all right, I guess it'll eventually stop. The noise you're hearing is a cell phone. Anyhow, since it is February, it is our health program, and I have for my guest this evening, Dr. John O Neill from the Adamstown Veterinary Hospital, and we're going to talk about some issues that we've been having with, dogs and COVID and, you know, the whole mess that's been going on. So, welcome to the show, Dr.
Well,
O Neill.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me this evening,
sure,
too.
Sure. The first thing I really want to cover is how the COVID affected your practice. Like, was it pros and cons? Was it was it good because you got more business because more people were buying puppies, or the bad part, you had to close the clinic because of, you know, the infection rate? So, you know, how was your practice affected?
So the practice was affected in many ways. So all the issues you just brought up. So first of all, we actually lost the personal touch. So unfortunately, we had to go curbside, which everybody knows about curbside.
Yes.
So you actually have to be called into the exam room. At one time, we actually had no clients in the room, which was very, very difficult to learn how to communicate with a client. So
Right. We
tried, we were actually using phones, cell phones, and actually we started doing some video recordings too when the clients were not in the actual exam room. So.
Oh, okay.
Then we actually went back to straight curbside, where the owners would actually be called into the waiting room and then actually brought into the exam room. And we kind of skipped actually seeing the receptionist and everything else to get that personal touch back.
Okay.
But the biggest thing is that I really think that the thing is, which all veterinarians and all clients like, is that the personal touch with the veterinarian and also the client and also the pets.
Right, right. Well, you like to know what's going on. You know, if I give my dog to you at my car and you take the dog in and you treat him and you come out and you say, well, this is what we did, but you're not seeing what the vet and the tech were doing while the dog was there. You know, you don't know. You don't even know how the dog was acting.
Correct.
I myself have a puppy, and I know the breed that I have is a little, you know, when they're young, they're sort of skitsy. And, I don't know. He'd probably be wild. I have no idea.
Yes. So the thing is, we try to still do fear-free in the hospital. Mm-hmm. So we use treats, whether it's, on the exam table, put either string cheese or spray cheese or peanut butter, try to keep the dogs so that way that their attention's on that and not focused on the veterinarian.
Right.
And then the thing is try to also, since a client's not in the room for the comfort of the dog, we actually try to do as limited a restraint as we possibly can and still get all of our physical exam done and get all of the answers we need so that way we can treat them properly.
Mm-hmm. Have you considered, like, since it's nice weather coming up, if you're going to continue with the curbside service, would you consider doing like examinations or shots outside?
We have done that. So we have a fenced-in area in the back of the hospital, so we actually have seen clients that want to be seen outside during the nice weather. We did start doing exams outside underneath a tent.
Right.
Again, it's just a matter of its evolution. COVID's taught us all how to change multiple different ways in order to actually effectively see the patients, and also, unfortunately, now the volume of patients has gone way up, too. Like you said in the beginning, we're seeing more puppies than we ever have in our entire many, many years.
Right. Well, they're calling it a puppy pandemic, you know. Everybody, since they were at home, they decided to get a pet.
Correct.
And unfortunately, it was a good idea, but, you know, you have company. Those puppies haven't been socialized.
Yeah, and that brings up another good point, too, because the thing is we're seeing a lot of puppies now that have not been socialized, which we're really, really trying to, in all of our puppy visits, trying to get the patients to puppy classes and training clubs and trying to get them interacted with other dogs, people, and everything else. So We do call them, unfortunately, the 2000s and 2001 models. The poor puppies are getting labeled as COVID dogs.
Yes.
And as you know, as a trainer and also owning a kennel and everything else, these dogs can actually become a problem.
Oh, yes.
And now we also see the other flip now as everybody was home. Now we see that everybody's back to work, and now we're seeing a lot of separation anxiety.
Yes.
Because these dogs, again, have been bonded to the owners, and now, unfortunately, the owner now has to go back to work.
Right.
I mean, many people are still working from home, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
But those of us that have gone back to the office, it's becoming a very challenge. So I think we as a practice, and I think as a profession, are seeing more and more dogs, and to a small extent, some cats that are having more separation anxiety than we ever have because of that human-animal bond is now broken.
Right, because now the poor dogs don't know what to do with themselves.
Correct.
You know, there was always somebody there. They didn't even really have to be house trained to go at a special time, to go outside at a special time, because the owner was always there. If they went to the door, the owner just got up and left them out. And, you know, now it's like, well, I have to hold it till 5 o'clock kind of thing.
Yeah.
So even there, they would have had problems. But, you know, I feel sorry for the poor dogs, because not getting into, you know, personal spaces with strangers.
Correct. And the biggest thing is we're really trying to work through all these problems, because the thing is we're also hearing on the other side of things, and I'm sure you have, is more dogs are now getting put back into shelter situations. And the thing is, we just definitely want to make sure we try to avoid that.
Yes.
And as just through Berks County Training Club and all the other different facilities in the area, I just hope that everybody gets out and actually gets their dogs socialized.
Right.
And
right.
Even if it's bringing them to the park, you know, and doing fun activities.
Right.
Not just, you know, staying at home and everything else. Unfortunately, we're all becoming hermits.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. But I know with my puppy, I started to take him to Lowe's and Home Depot and Tractor Supply and, you know, training classes is only one day a week.
Yep.
I need to get my puppy out, so.
Yep, and the other thing is, too, is what we forgot, too, is as everybody was home with COVID and became more socialized in the house, we got out less and didn't exercise as much and take them for a walk and stuff where we could do during COVID. But again, we got so addicted to being inside and away from everybody. So it's socially changed all of us.
Yes, yes. But I mean, being outside, you don't, you know, outside it's fresh air.
That's right.
But
I think as we were driving around during COVID, I saw less and less people actually outside.
That's exactly right.
And then, you know, even during the first day of fishing season a couple of years ago when they opened it everything at one time and nobody knew, there was a lot of people out, but then all of a sudden there was nobody.
Right.
So
right.
It was just crazy.
Yeah. And, you know, it's what, going on 3 years?
Yep.
3 years that this has been affecting us. So it's just a shame. It's just a shame.
And the biggest thing about the veterinary community, all veterinary practices went through this. The sad thing is most of us then actually got COVID into our practices, and we were short-staffed. And so I tell everybody today, just be patient with all your veterinarians, all your veterinary staff. We're all working very, very hard.
Right.
To actually get you know, get you guys seen, you know, get the exams done correctly, get you to the right specialist if need be. But it's just a matter of it's hit everybody very hard, and unfortunately the staff feels all the stress and everything else too.
Sure, yeah, because they're now overworked.
Correct.
They're now overworked because there are more dogs that coming in, and it's difficult with most purebred dogs. When you buy a purebred puppy from a reputable breeder, you're going to get a contract, and they want that puppy checked within 7 to 10 days after you bring it home.
Yep.
Which is very difficult in this time, because it's like, well, I can't get an appointment in 7 to 10 days, because there are some vets that, you know, you have to wait a month to give a month, 2 months to get into.
Yeah, and that's one of the, again, it goes back to this shortage of people.
That's exactly
that are
right.
not coming back into the veterinary field.
Because
as you said about burnout and just tired and fatigue.
Right.
But so the thing is, yes, there are veterinarians out there. It could be a week, 2 weeks, you know, a month before you can have your puppy seen. You're correct. And so hopefully some of the purebred breeders actually see this too and maybe work with the contractor, work with the individual if they can't be seen.
Yes.
And I know we do the same thing with, we breed dogs in Newfoundlands, and we really try to work with all of our puppy people just to say, hey, we tell them up front, you may not get in with your veterinarian for a couple weeks or 3 weeks.
Right. Yeah, but it's just another, you know, step in the process. It's like, oh my God, now what kind of thing. But so what about the adults? Now that you have the adults coming in as well, are you seeing any special kind of problems now that people are home with your dogs? They're noticing more about their dogs? Are they overweight? Are, you know, is he limping? So are you seeing any difference there?
I think we're seeing the dogs sooner than later.
Okay.
So I think that some of the disease processes we're seeing are getting identified earlier because people are home and the dog may, unfortunately, when we leave for work, we may not see the dog vomit during the day. The
right.
dog cleans it up himself,
right.
unfortunately, just as his dog behavior. Mm-hmm. And then when we come home, we might see a little spot of maybe bile on the rug, and
right.
it may go a couple days. But when you're home and you're actually seeing them actively vomit or
yeah.
having diarrhea in the house where you have to clean it up, I think people are calling sooner and trying to get in.
Right.
And as you brought up before, unfortunately, the number of limited slots,
mm-hmm.
It just becomes a challenge. And I can tell you, just as a owner of the business, actually we have two veterinary practices, and it just becomes harder and harder to get everybody seen because people do want to be seen. It's just a matter of how
right.
quickly we can get them in.
Right, right. And I would assume that the emergency clinics are just as bad, because if you can't see a dog in an emergency, they're going to go to,
yep.
one of the other emergencies, and you may wait. You know, your dog has an emergency, and unless it's bleeding in the car, I would assume that you'd probably wait 3, maybe 4 hours
yep.
to be seen by the emergency vet.
And we have an emergency vet right here in Berks, right
mm-hmm.
here in, right outside of Reading.
Right.
And the thing is, you're correct. So what they usually do is they're triaging everybody, as we do in a case of an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to see what time, when can they be seen. But you're correct. In like a dire emergency, maybe seen right away.
Right.
Because it's, it's a dire emergency.
Right.
But
right.
if it's something like a cut toenail that's bleeding or something, you may have to wait 3 or 4 or 5 hours. I've actually had some clients tell me they've waited 8 hours.
Oh, my
at an emergency clinic,
wow.
almost
yeah.
like we do now on the human
yeah.
side.
Yeah.
We're waiting in the human hospitals for that long, too, to
That's
be seen.
That's exactly right.
So
That's
it's happening
exactly
in both
right.
professions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because I know they're sending people down to Lancaster as
yeah.
well, and even as far down as
Malvern.
As Hope in Malvern.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we're sending everybody now. Sometimes we're sending them as far as outside of Philadelphia.
Really?
There's two big referral centers outside of Philadelphia that are
mm-hmm.
starting, and unfortunately, they're at capacity, too.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
And again, so. It's the same thing. I was just talking to one of the owners of actually VRC. It's in Malvern.
Okay.
And they actually had COVID go through their staff as everybody else did. And so,
mm-hmm.
again, limited number of appointments and everything else.
Right, right, right.
It's yeah. been a real tough time living through this pandemic.
Yeah. Yes, yes, it has been. And are we done yet? They're saying the
Delta, avian. Omicron or something.
Yeah, 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 the Oklahoma. No, no, they're saying it's a whole new pandemic. I think it's
the avian flu
is coming back.
Well, they said that the avian flu actually they said is coming, but they've actually found it in some wild birds.
Right.
Actually, it was in the front of Lancaster Farming this past week.
Oh, okay.
They had isolated that, and they're really worried about the wild bird population bringing it into,
mm-hmm.
unfortunately, into all of our chickens and turkeys
yes.
and
yes.
or whether they're on our farm or actually our barnyard stuff that we actually have at our house. So
right, right.
that's a real concern too on the feathered
right.
side of things.
That's
for
exactly
the,
right.
for another flu.
But they're saying that it's not only affecting birds now. This new avian flu
could
has
yeah.
affected two people in China or something like that.
Okay.
I just read it's like, okay, they're over in China, let them stay there, we don't need another pandemic. But yeah, well, so if the dog is like, if a dog needs their vaccinations,
yep.
and they can't get an appointment within a specified period of time, if the dog is due and you send out the reminder, and it's like, okay, the dog is due it, this month, the dog is due. Well, I can't get in this month. So are you seeing that portion of them, or?
We are, because remember with the pandemic, people were not allowed out for a while
mm-hmm.
and doing just the essentials. So we're seeing an overflow of, rabies vaccines and everything else and
mm-hmm.
Distemper and things that need to be caught up. So what we're trying to do is, again, same thing, try to triage, get the people in that the vaccines are going to expire. Like one of them would be Lyme vaccine.
Yes.
Because remember, that actually has a shorter window and it needs to be boosted sooner. So we're trying to look at that too when they're calling in and trying to get them placed in the appropriate places. But yes, unfortunately, some things are getting are going over and we have to restart stuff.
Right, right. Well, now that you mentioned the Lyme vaccine, what shots do you actually recommend and at what period of time?
So in the state of Pennsylvania, we start out with the rabies vaccine.
Yes.
In the state of Pennsylvania, they want them all vaccinated at 12 weeks, which you and I as breeders know that there's a lot of controversy over that.
Yes,
so just
is.
Going by the state laws, and then they need to be boosted at a year, and then after that, every 3 years with the state of Pennsylvania.
Okay.
And then one of the core vaccines, as we see, you know, recommended by AVMA and all your different veterinary clinics is, you know, your distemper, parvo, parainfluenza, and hepatitis. That's a vaccine that's given in boosters, just like in children. And then they give it in boosters every 3 to 4 weeks until they're 16 weeks, depending on the veterinary practice and what, of course, whatever vaccine protocol comes with the vaccine itself.
Mm-hmm.
And then booster to a year. And then we're trying to go with that vaccine to every 3 years because trying to lessen the load of, as you know, antigen and everything else.
Right, right, right.
And then after that, you know, boarding, as you know, with a boarding kennel and dog training and everything else. We see a lot of dogs with upper respiratory, so Bordetella is another one that's given every year because it is a Bacter. And, and so it's something that I think is, if your dog's out and social, again, do the risk assessment.
And I don't think people even think of, you know, going, when they go to dog park, well, and maybe they're not going to dog parks at this point any time either. But I don't think people even thought about them going to dog parks, interacting with other dogs, and getting the Bordetella, which, you know,
and that's another one that we've, again, was we were socially more in our own little social groups. We probably didn't need to worry about that vaccine.
You didn't
now,
have to.
As we see more and more people, as we came in tonight, you see people out with their dogs and socializing and everything. So the thing is that vaccine's one that's, it's again, very, very transmissible, you know, oral nasal. And so the thing is, it's something we probably should talk about. Now this is, the dogs are getting out and about again with their clients. The nice thing about that vaccine, you give it once. In the nose and oral, you know, and then that's good for a year.
Yes, yes.
So,
what about that? The new, what was that? H1N2,
so,
or something like that.
Yes, yeah. So the canine flu, as we all know, actually, there's two different varieties of that, and we saw the different strains come through. It was in different boarding kennels and. Again, as a higher concentration of dogs in one area, population medicine, of course, you're going to be able to spread it very easy. So the thing is, we saw it come as like a wave, almost like we are now with the flu we're dealing with. But the thing is, and then it kind of goes away.
Yeah.
And then, as you know, reading as a, you know, also handling dogs and also showing dogs, about two, right before the pandemic, I think it was 19, do you remember that bulldog and stuff, AKC, had it all over, actually got diagnosed and had passed from, unfortunately, canine flu, and then everybody in the entire world and the AKC world really then said, we should probably be vaccinating for it. So I think, again, something to talk to the owners about. I don't think it's a vaccine for every dog, but if it's a dog that's going to be at multiple dog shows and or training classes and stuff, again, I think you should talk to the owner and the veterinarian and go back to the breeder also and talk about that.
Right, right, right. Let's go back a bit to the Bordetella. I don't think people even know what Bordetella is.
Okay.
Because I've had friends call me and say that their dog is really coughing. You know, what do I think it is? Did the dog get a cold?
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, no, you got to get the dog to the vet. I don't think people, you want to explain about the Bordetella and how it affects the dog, what the dog does, that people would be able to recognize it?
Yep. So Bordetella is actually one of the components of what you're saying is kennel cough. So remember, just like anything else, is usually a virus comes in first. So the virus comes in, makes the dog's immune system a little bit lower or more susceptible. And then, so Bordetella is actually a bacteria. And so what happens is, and there's lots of bacteria that are normal flora in our actual upper airways and also in our lungs. And one of the other ones we see a lot in that complex is there's a lot of them. I mean, we do now a respiratory panel, which actually shows you viruses and also bacteria. One of the other ones we see a lot right now is neurovirus coming up on these, and where is it coming from? Yeah. Nobody really knows, again, much about it. It's kind of like a quick flu, a cold, they get it and it's out of them. So Bordetella actually gets, I think, is a big word for everybody to cover kennel cough.
Right.
And
right.
And a lot of times when we do these upper respiratory panels, because vaccine companies now are supporting this so they can see where the different outbreaks ever since the canine flu.
Okay.
They're actually, all these vaccine companies, if you get your vaccines at the veterinarian, you should ask your veterinarian if your dog goes to the kennel, comes back with kennel cough or Bordetella, to really ask them, hey, can you test my dog? Because most of the companies will cover the cost.
Okay.
And then we can see what it actually is. They're more interested than I think anybody else to see, are the vaccines working? And what else is out there? No different than what we're seeing now in this pandemic.
Right. That's exactly right.
So it's an interest, really good topic. But the thing is, I think we all look at Bordetella as the culprit of everything. And it's there's many other bugs, probably 10 to 15 other bugs that are involved.
Yeah. But the dog actually just coughs. You know, it's like they're gagging, you know, that it's a harsh cough and like they have something stuck in their throat.
And we can see cough, nasal congestion. We can see nasal discharge. We can also see ocular discharge.
And then
unfortunately, some of these dogs will get pneumonia.
Yes.
And then with the flu, as you know, through the AKC side, we saw about how high the fevers went.
Right.
So just like us with, you know, unfortunately with COVID, those of us have had it, you know, the thing is we know that that fever is part of it.
Right.
So the dog is very similar in the canine flu that they will get that. One of the standout with canine flu was the high fevers.
Yes. Yeah.
So
it's just a very peculiar. It's a peculiar disease, you know, and you think you're protecting the dog and, you know, you're not protecting the dog. There's always something else coming along. But let's talk a little bit, since it is February, let's talk about a little bit about dentistry.
Okay.
Since this is dental month, right?
Yep.
It's doggy dental month.
Now, the thing is, I don't know what veterinary practices are still doing doggy dental month since COVID has been about. Again, it goes back to what you said with all the troubles getting in.
Right.
So the thing is, yes, it is National Dental Month for dogs and cats. It's something that AVMA started many, many, many years ago to be more aware that, you know, unfortunately, about 70% of all of our dogs and cats have some type of underlying periodontal disease going on. Because until we flip the lip on the dog or cat and look inside, we don't really know what's going on. Besides, sometimes they may, you know, odor maybe come up in your face.
And
like, woof.
Right. With a doggy smell, doggy odor. It's like, no, it's bad teeth.
Or like you said, or somebody like calls and says, hey, my dog lost a tooth. Well, that's, you know, that's not normal. Once they're in, they should stay in and not just fall out. So, so dental month is a very good, it's a very educational thing. And there's lots of things on different websites about, you know, doggy dental and kitty dental.
Right.
So, and today, dentistry's come a full swing. You know, 25 years ago, it was a lot different than it is today. We do a lot of more advanced procedures. And I think dogs and cats dentals are, you know, getting very similar to humans.
Right. And yeah, you really should be brushing your dog's teeth, but who brushes their dog's teeth, right? So before we run out of time, let's talk a little bit about the boy that you brought.
Okay.
He is a Newfoundland,
yep.
Just in case nobody knew what he was. This big black bear, and he is big dog. Can you get up? Hey, Bo.
He's sleeping.
Oh, he's sleeping. Okay.
He's doing what Newfoundland's like to do. Rest.
Right. And, so, you know, a Newfoundland is not a high energy dog. It's big. And that's like most big dogs. They are not high energy. It's the medium sized dogs and the little dogs that drive you crazy. But yeah, he's resting all right.
So
but he's a big boy.
Yeah, Boeing has more credentials than I do. So Boeing actually is a dog that this is out of our first litter we've ever bred. And Boeing actually in the AKC world, he actually has been best in show, and he's also been multiple best in show specialties, and he's also got his platinum grand championship. So he's a very accomplished dog in the show ring.
Yes.
He also does obedience.
Oh, very good.
He, as a Newfoundland, they do working stuff. So carting, we have not got him in the water because remember, Newfoundlands are born rescue dogs.
Oh, yes.
And then he is actually a registered therapy dog.
Oh, wonderful.
And he's also has other things that he does too. Mm-hmm. So, but Boeing loves to be on the, we live on a farmette, and he just loves to be down on the farm and hanging out and getting dirty. So that's his biggest thing.
I think they all love that, getting dirty. It doesn't matter what breed it is. They like getting dirty. But yeah, he is a very nice boy. He's a very nice boy. Have you tried karting at all?
Yeah, we do kart. He has only been, we practiced a little bit.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, my wife actually does quite a bit of karting. We've actually got multiple karting titles in
a lot
of our
good.
Dogs. So
yeah.
It's fun. It's mm-hmm. something to get them out, especially in the spring and the fall.
Right.
Summertime for these guys, because of the heat, we try to keep them back in the water. But do a lot in the spring and fall, and sometimes in the wintertime too, depending on the footing.
Right. Well, they're carrying a heavy coat, so,
correct.
You know, it's like, you don't want to put them out in the summertime because they just get way too hot.
Yeah. They get overheated very quickly.
That's exactly right. Well, the black, I mean, you can't even touch the coat on a black dog, right?
Yeah,
you know, they're
summertime.
Out in the sun, and it's like, you know, oh my Lord.
You'd rather be laying out in a snowbank someplace.
Yes, yes, that's how my guys are too. they prefer it. This is their weather, So, yeah, we play in the snow and the ice and so. But anyhow, well, we didn't get through all of the things I wanted to cover, so, oh well.
I'm sorry.
But that's okay. I mean, we covered a lot. But anyhow, I guess that's our program for this evening. Next month, I'm pretty sure I'm going to have miniature bull terriers. It's March, and I thought, well, you know, an Irish dog, but I couldn't really find an Irish dog. So I thought, well, England is very close to Ireland, so we're going to have an English dog. But I think the mini bulls were started here in the United States. But they are, oh, now you're awake. You're going to stand up, boy.
Here, Bo. Come on.
Well, if I have to.
Oh, bother.
So you can see the size. He's bigger than the desk. But they are very gentle.
Oh, they're gentle giants.
Yes, they are very, very gentle dogs. Yes, yes.
Come here, Bo.
A lot of hair. A lot of hair, a lot of dog, a lot of slobber.
Lots of oh, there goes the slobber.
There goes the slobber. Oh, well. They just missed me. So if you want this breed of dog, you got to expect slobber. Isn't that right? Yes, you got to expect slobber. But it's a lot of dog. It's a lot of dog. They're wonderful dogs, but a lot of hair, right? So anyhow, the miniature bull terrier is our breed for next month. So for this evening, good night.
Good night.
About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.